Today we are going to start with Ernest Hemingway's The Old Man and the Sea. Now to discuss his life, he was born in 1899 and died in 1961. He was born in Oak Park, Illinois, and he started his career as a writer in a newspaper office in Kansas City at the age of 17. After the United States entered the First World War, he joined a volunteer ambulance unit in the Italian Army and was wounded in the process. After he came back to the United States, he became a reporter for Canadian and American newspapers and was soon sent back to Europe. Now we'll look at some of his works, which include The Sun Also Rises, Farewell to Arms, which is all about an ambulance officer's disillusionment in the war and his role as a deserter. Then his most ambitious novel, For Whom the Bell Tolls, in which Hemingway has used his experiences as a reporter during Civil War in Spain. Then, of course, The Old Man and the Sea, which is the journey of an old fisherman. Apart from that, there's Men Without Women and The Fifth Column and The First 49 Stories. Now, if you look at Old Man and the Sea, it was published in 1952, and in 1953, it was awarded the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction. Now, Old Man and the Sea is classified not as a novel, but as a novella. What is a novella? Novella is generally, it has the structure of a novel, but then in word count, it runs into something between 20,000 to 50,000 words. So on an average, it might have 30,000 words also. It is a story of an epic struggle between an old seasoned fisherman and the greatest catch of his life. For 84 days, Santiago, an aged Cuban fisherman, had set out to sea and returned empty-handed. He is labeled as unlucky, and the parents of his young, devoted apprentice and friend, Manolin, have forced the boy to leave the old man in order to join a more prosperous boat. Nevertheless, the boy continues to care for the old man. He brings in newspapers for him, discusses the latest developments in American baseball, especially the trials of the old man's hero, Joe DiMaggio. Now, this old man finally decides to set out to sea, and that happens for continuation of 84 days. He had been unlucky, not catching any fish. So on the 85th day, the turning point comes and he decides to venture into the Gulf Stream and prepares his lines and drops them. At noon, a big fish, which he knows is a marlin, takes the bait that Santiago had placed 100 fathoms deep in the water. The old man expertly hooks the fish, but he cannot pull it. Why? Because it was a huge fish. Instead, the fish begins to pull the boat. It does so for 2 days and two nights and exhausts itself as well as Santiago. Then finally, on the third day, the fish tires. Santiago himself is in a very bad state. He has been sleep deprived. He's aching. Bones are aching. He's bleeding at places where the line had cut his body. Nearly delirious, manages to pull the marlin in close enough to kill it with a harpoon thrust. So he finally kills it with a harpoon. He respects the marlin and its struggle to live. He is concerned that the people who will eat the fish are unworthy of its greatness. He is convinced that the marlin is indeed a very great fish, and at one place he also refers to it as his brother. Now if you look at the characters in the novella, we find, of course, the hero is there, Santiago. He is the protagonist of the novella. He is an old fisherman in Cuba who at the beginning of the book has not caught anything for 84 days. The novella follows Santiago's quest for the great catch that will save his career. Santiago endures a great struggle with an uncommonly large and noble marlin, like we discussed right now. But by the time he is able to bring it to the shore, it's all eaten up by the hungry sharks, and he only manages to reach the shore with the head and the tail part. Nevertheless, Santiago ends the novel with his spirit undefeated because he had finally managed to get a catch. Coming to the next character, very important character of Manolin, who is Santiago's only friend and companion. Santiago taught Manolin to fish, and the boy used to go out to sea with the old man until his parents objected. They said that Santiago is unlucky, stop going with him, and he was sent in to work on another boat. But Manolin still helps Santiago pull in his boat in the evenings and provides the old man with food and bait when he needs it. Manolin is the reader's surrogate in the novel, appreciating Santiago's heroic spirit and skill despite his outward lack of success. Then we have the marlin. The marlin also, the fish, is a very important character in the book. Although he does not speak and we do not have access to his thoughts, the marlin is certainly an important character in the novella. The marlin is a fish Santiago spends the majority of the novel tracking, killing, attempting to bring to shore. The marlin is larger and more spirited than any fish Santiago has ever seen. Santiago idealizes the marlin, ascribing to it traits of great nobility, a fish to which he must prove his own nobility if he is to be worthy of catching it. Then the sea also is a character in the novella. As its title suggests, the sea is a central character in the novella. See the title, The Old Man and the Sea. Most of the story takes place on the sea, and Santiago is constantly identified with its creatures, with it and its creatures. His sea-colored eyes reflect both the sea's tranquility and power, and its inhabitants are his brothers. Santiago refers to the sea as a woman, and the sea seems to represent the feminine complement to Santiago's masculinity. The sea might also be seen as the unconscious from which creative ideas are drawn. So the sea also is a very important character. Now if we look at the themes in the novella, number one theme is unity. Now apparently contradictory elements are repeatedly shown as aspects of one unified whole. Like the sea is both kind and cruel. It's feminine also, it's masculine also. The Portuguese man of war is beautiful but deadly. The Marco shark is noble but cruel. As long as he focuses on this unity and sees himself as part of nature rather than as an external antagonist competing with nature, he cannot be defeated by whatever misfortunes befall him. And that is why Santiago is undefeated. Now, theme two is heroism. Hemingway's vision of heroism is Sisyphean. Now, Sisyphean means requiring continuous labor for essentially ephemeral ends. What the hero does is to face adversity with dignity and grace, hence Hemingway's neo-stoic emphasis on self-control and the other facets of his idea of manhood. What we achieve or fail at externally is not as significant to heroism as maintaining inner goodness. As Santiago says, man is not made for defeat. A man can be destroyed, but not defeated. Theme 3 is manhood. Hemingway's ideal of manhood is nearly inseparable from the ideal of heroism. In his ethical universe, Santiago shows us not only how to live life heroically, but also in a way befitting man. To be a man is to behave with honor and dignity, to not succumb to suffering, to accept one's duty without complaint, and most importantly, to display a maximum of self-control. The representation of femininity, the sea, is characterized expressly by its caprice and lack of self-control. If she did wild or wicked things, it was because she could not help them. So the sea is feminine, she has no self-control. But man, and Santiago himself, that masculinity inside him teaches to have the maximum self-control. The representation of masculinity of the marlin is described as great, beautiful, calm, noble. Santiago steels himself against his pain by telling him to suffer like a man or a fish, referring to the marlin, because marlin also is a symbol of masculinity, manhood. Theme 4. Now that's pride. A heroic man like Santiago should have pride in his actions, and as Santiago shows us, humility was not disgraceful and it carried no loss of true pride. So it's not bad to be humble. Santiago's pride presses him to travel dangerously far out into the sea, beyond all people in the world, to catch the marlin. So what does he do? Just because he had to prove a point, he goes to a point in the sea where nobody ventured out because it was dangerous. While he loved the marlin and called him brother, Santiago admits to killing it for pride, his blood stirred by battle with such a noble and worthy antagonist. Hemingway suggests that pride in a job well done, even if pride drew one unnecessarily into the situation, is a positive trait. Theme number 5 is success. Hemingway talks of two different types of success. One is outer, one is inner. Outer is material success, inner is spiritual success. While Santiago clearly lacks the former, the importance of this lack is eclipsed by his possession of the latter. So, you know, when we talk about material success, Santiago had nothing with him. But spiritual success he definitely had. Santiago's story is a triumph of an undefeated spirit over exhaustible material resources, things which you can touch and feel. They are subject to exhaustion, they can be finished. Such a spirit is characterized by heroism and manhood. That Santiago can end the novella undefeated after steadily losing his hard-earned, most valuable possession is a testament to the privileging of inner success over outer success. Theme 6 is worthiness. One must constantly demonstrate one's heroism and manliness through actions conducted with dignity. Interestingly, worthiness cannot be conferred upon oneself. Santiago is obsessed with proving his worthiness to those around him. Why? Because everybody calls him unsuccessful, unlucky. He had to prove himself to the boy. The 1,000 times he had proved it, meaning nothing. Now he was proving it again. Each time was a new time, and he never thought about the past when he was doing it. And he had to prove himself to the Marlin also. I'll kill him in all his greatness and glory, although it is unjust, but I will show him what a man can do and what a man endures. A heroic and manly life is not one of inner peace and self-sufficiency. It requires constant demonstration of one's worthiness through noble actions. Now, if you have any questions with regard to this particular novella, The Old Man and the Sea, please put it down in the segment below and I shall try and answer them. Thank you.